Hello, fellow crafters. Are you looking for ways to simplify your paper crafting and still have professional results? In this video, we are going to cover a simple strategy to create this card with Colleen.
Hi, this is Colleen.
And Carrie.
From Scissors to Paper Crafting, where we give you tips, tricks, and strategies that make creating fun, simple, and easy to follow. Today, we'll be making an A2 card with a hummingbird and a flower. So let's create!
All of today's supplies will be linked in the description below. I really, really like this card, Colleen. It is simply stunning.
I really enjoyed making this card. It's so pretty. We're going to start with an A2 card base. I'm using 110-pound black cardstock from Michaels.
We are going to place our 8.5 by 11-inch cardstock into our trimmer with the 11-inch side against the ruler. Trim at 5.5 and then grab your scoreboard. We're going to score our base on the 11-inch side at 4.25 inches. Now, with this method, you will get two card bases, but today we're only going to be using one of them.
I'm using my mini scoreboard today from Dress My Craft. I think it's so adorable.
It's like baby scoreboard.
Don't forget to use your bone folder to go and crease the side and hold it down to where it's a tighter fit.
And leaving your cardstock on your scoreboard as you fold it will help get you a more even fold.
Our topper today is 110-pound white cardstock from Michaels.
We cut our layers to a 16th of an inch from our base card, but you can use 1/8 or 1/4 inch or whatever size you actually want if you want a larger border beneath it.
Instead of wasting paper, I grabbed a piece from our bin, which is our scrap collector, and already pre-cut it to 4.125 inches.
Our ink blend today, we are going to start with a Ranger Distressed Oxide Ink in Mermaid Lagoon. This is going to create our sky on our cloud. Colleen will be using a cloud embossing folder from Spellbinders. The link will be in the description. One of the things that really helps with embossing is to spray your cardstock before placing it into your embossing folder and running it through the machine. This allows the fibers of the paper to just relax, and as it runs through the machine, they will push into the grooves of the folder and you will have a more even spread on your embossing, and they'll go deeper and it's just so beautiful.
I'm using a Bristol paper to cut the dies for my bird, flower, and hello sentiment.
We found using Bristol paper helps the ink to blend evenly, giving our card more of a professional look. The brushes that we use to apply our inks are straight from Amazon. They're just basic Amazon brushes. And we're going to start blending our flower in a Colleen custom blend. And the reason I say that is because this woman, I'm telling you, she spends hours in our inks trying to see how many, or at least I think she tries to see how many different colored inks she can put to a project. And all the ink blending she's been doing over these last couple months have really just taken her to another level. One I can't catch up to, and sometimes that makes me very sad.
But you do an excellent job yourself.
Thank you.
You really do. Hang on a second. Having a little technical difficulty with getting my one die out.
Oh no, her flowers are stuck.
They're stuck in there.
Oh no. Is it the little stamens?
It's the stamens.
It helps if you rock the paper a little bit. There you go. And they kind of free themselves.
We're working on it here. There we go.
So we're going to start blending our flower.
This is so pretty. Blending ink is not difficult if you have the right supplies. You want to make sure that you tap off after you apply your ink. You want to make sure that you tap off so it's not too much that you're putting on. and you have an even spread, like so. And this is important to make sure that you tap it off.
It absolutely is. And a light touch here is key. I cannot stress that enough. When I started blending, like I said before, my colors were a Crayola box. They were always dark and even all the way across. Where with the method that she's doing with these flowers, where you're going to be blending one color into the next, you want them to be light and airy and fluffy. Next, we're going to jump to our second color, which is Hero Arts. It's one of their ombres, Tide Pool to Navy. But Colleen is only going to use the center color. She really does like to keep us on our toes. Same method as before. Apply the brush to the center of the pad. Tap off onto either paper, or if you have a blending mat like Colleen has, you can use that. And then apply the brush to the center of the pad. And you're just going to go about halfway up the flower, like you see her doing there. Just kind of go just halfway up.
Gives a nice little look.
Can you pull that closer to the camera a little bit so they can... Yeah, that's really pretty. And there's still some white in there. Like, she did not saturate that piece at all. And, you know, leaving that space to show the next color is just... Ugh, I'm so jealous.
You'll get there. You'll get there.
You always told me, don't worry if it's not perfect.
That's right, because it's all about handmade. And... it shows somebody that you care, that you did that little bit extra to give them, that you thought of them.
Yeah, it's true.
In between, I need to clean off my mat a little bit.
Yes, those colors will mix together. For the stamen in our flower is Sunflower from Archival Inks. And again, same process. Same method. The only thing that's going to change here is you're going to ink both sides of the stamen.
I'm going to decide to do something a little new and different.
Now keep in mind, Colleen has had time to semi-master this technique. Unlike myself, I'm still trying to get the blend she achieves.
We're getting there. Just be careful that you don't go and rip off your little pieces as you're trying to go and put your paints on.
Oh, that's just the worst when that happens. It absolutely is. But, you know, you do tell me I have a unique way of doing ink.
Definitely a unique way. Definitely a unique way.
Don't worry, guys. You'll get to see it.
Okay. So now that the stamen's done, we're going to move on to our hummingbird. And with the hummingbird, I decided to use Brilliance Pearlescent Lavender ink. This ink, you have to be careful that you don't apply too much on.
It's very pretty. It does, as she said, it has an iridescence to it, but that word doesn't even give it justice. It really doesn't. I mean, it just looks like you've put some kind of embossing powder on it. Some of the Brilliance inks, like this one, do have the additive that creates that shimmer. In our experience, these inks do take a bit longer to dry than the non-iridescent ones. So be sure that you use an even lighter touch when you ink up your brush than when you did with the other inks.
My next color, am I moving on?
No, stay still. I think they're all caught up now.
Okay, that's good to know.
Up next we have
Festive Berries.
That's what happens when you use too many inks, you know. Then you lose track of what colors you use.
Yeah, that's true. But it looks so pretty at the end project.
I'm not going to deny that. I'm really not. Not at all. So she's going to use this one on the wings. And they're going to blend down into the body.
About midway, yeah. I decided to... But it's your choice. It's your bird. It's your choice.
That kind of looks like Ruby. I have a galah cockatoo that looks like that. She's that color. Gray and pink. So she's really, really pretty.
Well, I researched hummingbird colors, and this just kind of like struck me as one of the colors.
Oh my, you even researched this?
I researched hummingbird colors.
Using blends this way, they really do give a polished look. They come together so quickly, and like it's like you spent hours creating them, And Colleen picked this method up so quickly. It's
one of my favorites.
Yeah, but you haven't been, how long have you been blending ink?
6 months?
Ugh.
Maybe.
I can't stand her sometimes.
I think so.
I'm snailing behind her and I started before she did. But that's okay because everyone has their own thing.
Their niche, yeah.
I do textures.
I can't do Copics.
Well, yeah, I do the Copics, but I do the textured stuff too. I like adding the texture and things. So our next, what are we doing? The Hello Dye next?
The Hello Dye Bubble, which is the bubble. I'm using Mode Lawn.
Distress Oxide Mode Lawn. This application is the same as the others, but there's a tip here. On this one and on the next piece, you can use tweezers, you can use your pokey tool, you can use whatever you need to use to keep your paper still. Now, she has it on a blending mat, and the blending mat kind of has this, I don't know.
It's a little bit textured.
Yeah, it's a little textured, but it doesn't move. Like the stuff that you put on, it really doesn't move easily. It moves easier than silicone, because if you've ever put an ink down on a piece of silicone and tried to move it just by pushing it, you can't. The stuff sticks like glue. Scrapbook.com, I know, has them. They're these little, like, slight tacky mats where you can put things on and then do your little blending. Or you can use, I've seen people use magnetic boards, but I'd like to hear from you guys. You know, what are you using to hold these little pieces down?
Besides fingernails?
Yeah, I was going to say, why don't you tell them how you do it?
I use my fingernails to go and do it. So that way my fingers don't get prints on anything. My nails kind of stay out of the way.
I will never forget that when you were doing those little tiny pieces and then you went and you touched a stark white card base and I think you had different colored inks on all of your fingers and it looked like a 7-year-old with chocolate just touched a wall.
It's kind of funny though.
So, you know, ask us how we know, but be careful not to ink your fingers and then touch anything that you don't want prints on. Seriously, what we do is we keep a water bottle, a little spray bottle, and a lint-free cloth at our workstation. I know some people use alcohol, some people use hand sanitizer, but as much as we shift off using one product after the next, our hands, if we had to use alcohol on them or hand sanitizer on them constantly, they would crack. Saltwater taffy on the Hello, Mowed Lawn on the Bubble.
Yes. And be careful with the Hello because that's one of those things like the stamen. The letters can rip easy if you're not careful when you're trying to blend on it. We have our Sizzix paper sculpting kit, all our stylus that we end up needing to go, and the pad that we need for the flower to sculpt it.
This sculpting kit is one of my favorite craft items. Like, I may not be able to ink blend or watercolor or...
You do flowers amazing.
What else can you do? Do you do oil paint? No, I'm just kidding. But one of the things that I can do pretty well are these things. I watched so many different videos and I even took a couple of online classes. These things are so much fun. You get two different pads. One is the real thick one, like she's using there, and then there's a thinner one. The big thick one is for when you want the deeper scores, and you do wet your paper. You want to wet it on the opposite side that you're working on. And then what she's doing now is she is taking her smallest box that comes in three different sizes. She's taking the smallest one and she's pushing and doing circles, or you can do lines. But what you want to do is you want to keep doing that, and you can apply a lot of pressure on these. They're very firm. I have not ripped a flower. Have you ripped a flower?
Not yet.
I have ripped them before when I used to use a styrofoam one, and that just didn't work for me. But you're going to just press along those, like she's doing there, you press it and push to the outside. And what you're going to find that happens is the edges are going to start to curl on the tips. Once you see those petally-like edges start to curl up, that's when you take your tool and you trace along the outside of the petals and just go from one petal to the next until you're back at the beginning. And then you're going to shift it out from the small ball to the large.
I just have one more petal to do.
I'm talking faster than you're working. I'm so sorry. Don't feel rushed. Don't feel rushed. Well, you've practiced this, what, only like 3 or 4 times at most?
Yeah. And then you sent me a video, and I watched a different way of doing it than how I did it before. And I think it comes out so much nicer.
Oh, it does. Because that's how, when you use a tool and how they're designed to be used, you just get so much of a better result. So what you're going to do here is you're going to take your medium, she's using the medium one, your medium size ball, and you're going to just see how she's making those tiny circles. Well, as she's doing that, she's applying pressure to the flower. And what'll happen is it'll start to lift a little bit more. And crinkles are fine. Those little crinkles that it's putting in there, that gives the flower more dimension. It gives it more of a realistic look. My niece, Chrissy, when we did the summer, was it in the summer that we did that creation class?
Yeah, it was last year.
They did magnolia flowers. And my niece, Christina, really did a bang up job at doing the magnolia flower. And then you're going to take your largest ball right to the center of the flower like she's doing, apply some pressure, and just move in circles. You just keep moving in circles, and eventually that paper is just going to fold up like a blooming flower in reverse. Look at that.
It looks awesome.
It is just so, so cool. When I showed her that, she was amazed.
I'm still amazed.
The more pressure you apply, the higher up these petals are going to come. The more pressure you apply to the edges, the more curl you're going to get. And watch how quick the stamen comes together.
And this is the reason why we had to do the stamen front and back on the paint, is because it's going to go and lift up.
Yeah, that thing lifts up all the way too. But she's taking, again, it's the same method, but it's just a smaller circle. So instead of like working out wrinkles or whatever, you're just pressing and twisting it, aren't you?
Yes.
Yeah, she's just pressing it down and then twisting it a little bit. And it's giving her the same wrinkles, the same pullback. And if you're not happy with how that goes, and some people don't, what you can do is you can use reverse tweezers or regular tweezers, and you can hand curl them up. I have done that before. When I was first learning, I got too impatient, and I think maybe that's why I can't do the ink blends like you can. I just get impatient.
Impatient, yeah.
I need it to be quicker. But just keep working in that same circular motion all the way around.
I go to the medium ball,
mm-hmm.
And I do the center.
Same circle. Watch how quickly this thing comes up.
And it's just like, you know, like how the spider's legs go.
Yeah. See, I don't like spiders. I'm done. I don't even want to think about it. Mm-mm. Nope. Nope. Nope.
It's really pretty cool doing it.
And the thing about it is, if you wet them before you train the paper, once it dries, it's really hard to get to go flat again. It doesn't just go flat. Even if she were to push down on it once it's like completely dry, it has this natural thing it wants to do now, and it wants to curl up.
There you go. That looks pretty good.
It does.
How's that?
Got a nice lift in that.
Okay, so now comes the best part. Let's start assembling.
Yay!
Woo! So excited. Okay, first we're going to start off with the flower. And we want to make sure that we put the stamen in the center of the flower, so that way everything's attached before you glue it to the card.
Just be careful not to squish those sides. They're so delicate. They can bend very, very easily.
Little dab will do you.
Colleen's favorite saying when it comes to glue.
And I get my ball tool and press it down. It doesn't take that long, just long enough.
Just long enough to adhere it. It'll dry the rest of this glue cures in 24 hours, but it sets very quickly. Which one are you using?
I'm using the Art Glitter Glue.
Okay. Yeah, that one sets pretty quick too. But they fully cure in 24 hours, so.
So we have our flower aside. And now we're going to add our topper to the card, as long as we have the card facing the right way, to the card base.
Look at them pretty clouds.
Little dabble do you around the whole thing.
Did you color both sides? You did color both sides.
Yeah, I wasn't sure which side was going to come out good.
Okay. So that's your secret.
Yeah. You don't want to put it down. You don't want to push it down all the way until you make sure that it's in the right spot. Then you grab your boom folder. And I'm using my curved boom folder today, so that way it doesn't mess up the embossing.
Yeah, if you've ever used a flat side of a boom folder before on an embossed piece, you will push the embossing right out of it. Especially if it's a paper that you've wet that hasn't fully cured and dried, you will flatten the embossing back out.
No, this looks really nice. Okay, now I'm going to take my flower, put a little dab on the back of my flower, and you kind of want to make sure, you definitely want to make sure that there's enough space for your sentiment and your hummingbird. So we get our ball tool. I decided right here today. And you press it down just for a minute or a few seconds.
I was going to say, I don't even think it takes a minute. I think it's like 10, 15 seconds and it sticks.
Just long enough. Then I'm going to grab my hello and add the glue to the back of my hello.
This is where you can do one of two things. You can either do a small bead or you can do just dots, because you do want to make sure that you get all around these letters so that they don't pop up.
And I'll place it like so in the center of my bubble. I like my bubble.
Yeah, I know you do. You like your verbiage too. Bubble, thingy.
And we want to make sure that we varnish, I believe is the correct word, the hello down. And if a little bit of glue comes out, it's fine because it dries clear. You can also get a wet towel and like a moist towel and just go and wipe it off. So we got that down there.
Now with the art glitter glue, that one dries like a matte clear. So that one's not, if you leave a little bit of glue behind and you just kind of wipe it and you don't get all of it, I've noticed that that one's not as noticeable as it is with my Barely Arts glue, which I love. But if I, you know, over glue it, little bit seeps out and I just wipe it without making sure I got it all off of there, I'll see a sheen to it later. So what I discovered, here's a tip, the mono erasers, and you can find them at Michael's, Hobby Lobby. I think they even sell them at Walmart. And what they are is they have a little bit of sand inside of them, so they will take all of it right off. Some people say the rubber erasers work as well. Didn't have as much luck with those as I did with the mono erasers.
So we went and we put the hello on there. So I put mine on the angle. It's your preference on how you would like to go and put your hello, your sentiment on there. The next thing that we're going to do is add our hummingbird. And instead of gluing the hummingbird down, I'm going to make it stand up a little bit with dots, with square
foam squares.
If I can get it out right. I pre-cut a couple small pieces, but the little tiny foam squares fit really nice on the hummingbird in a couple spots. And then I just did a couple smaller pieces just for the wings to make sure that they hold nice and they're not bending around or anything.
Now, a card like this, I'm not so sure you'd want to throw this in an envelope and stick it in the mail. I think this would have to be one of the hand-delivered type cards, unless you were to put it in to what's called a card box, which I did make one the other day. I'm not sure where it is, though. But an A2 card box. We got ours. Ours is a die cut. And we got it from Amazon, of course. It's from, what is it,
KS Craft.
And that's pretty neat. It has like the stitching design. It's really, really cool. So our pop-ups, that's kind of how we plan on mailing them. Can't tell you how much that costs yet because I kind of want to visit the post office. We've already talked about seeing if we could go in with the camera and maybe interview our postmaster to see, you know, what exactly are the guidelines for using these card boxes. Which is just basically a boxed envelope for a card with some pop-ups on it. It's nothing special, but if they run it through that machine that they run every letter through, they will damage the box and they will damage your 3D things like this. Unless you put it in, like, I've heard bubble envelopes that you might have.
Oh, that's a good idea.
There's a few different ways to do it, but I definitely want to check with our post. Our postmaster is really, really chill here, so I'm sure that he'll either give us an answer, but it'd be really neat if he would just let us film him so he can, you know, become YouTube famous. Woohoo!
Okay, so I'm applying the hummingbird like so. It looks darling. Just darling. So we're almost finished.
I feel like I should be making a checkered flag because you keep saying, hey, we're almost finished.
No, we really are almost finished.
Like it's a lap around the racetrack?
Because of using the black for our A2 cardstock, I'm using a blue cardstock to add on the inside for the message that you want to put.
That's a good idea.
So it's this really pretty blue. I cut it the same size as the topper, the 4 1/8 by 5 1/4 inches. But this, I'm going to snazz it up some by going and doing some corner punches with our Dress My Craft corner puncher. And these give it a little bit of flair to it. So pretty. Kind of matches the rest of the card.
It does. I love our Dress My Craft decorative punches. I really do. We have, I think, 3 or 4 of them. Not many. We really don't go out and like buy like a whole bulk load of stuff. We just go and get the things that we like, the things that we enjoy, and the things that make our stuff look pretty. But if you'll notice, she really is just putting a dab on the corners, because if they stick up, they get caught on stuff. So you do need to make sure that you get your edges down. And cameras add like 20 pounds to glue like they do people.
We're going to varnish this also. But first you want to put it down to where it fits right in there. Give me a second here to line it up. And you treat this the same as your topper. And you just do your that's the inside of the card.
It's so pretty.
So the very last thing that I'm doing is I'm going to add my gems. And I'm going to put 3 pearl essence gems on the front of my card.
They're not white. They actually have kind of like a
sheen to them.
A sheen and a blue and stuff to it. You just can't. I don't know. Sometimes these cameras don't pick color up. Any camera gurus out there that can help us out? Comment below.
Comment. Give us comments. We like comments.
We like comments.
Don't forget to subscribe.
Oh, absolutely. Please. We love crafting with you. I hope we get to craft with you again. And as we go on, you'll get to watch us grow. Like as we get better, you'll be like, I remember them when.
Colleen wouldn't talk.
No, that was the first video. You just would not speak.
Oops. Okay. And there we have it, our hello card.
This is when I need one of those cheering sound effects.
Woo woo!
That card is so cute.
I love it. I absolutely love it.
Great job, Colleen.
Thank you so much.
If you guys enjoyed this Create with Colleen episode, be sure to hit that subscribe button. We'd love to craft with you again, as we've already said. We love having you here.
We have a Facebook group.
Yes, we do.
So it's Scissors to Paper Crafting. So feel free to join and like our page. We want to see more of your cards. I can't wait to see what you've done with the tools that you've been given today and the tips. Hit the notification button so that you don't miss out on any of our episodes. And we're here to get better.
We are.
That's right.
Growing together.
That's right.
As our channel grows, we plan on growing. And who knows, maybe by next year, I'll be able to blend colors better.
That would be great.
I really hope it doesn't take me a year.
I hope it doesn't take a year neither.
We can only go up from here, right?
That's true.
Make sure you do check out that Facebook group. One of the things with our Facebook group, they get notifications on our monthly giveaways a lot faster.
Yes.
A lot of times we're doing shorts. We don't have time to put it in there. Joining our Facebook group actually puts you in touch with so much more than it does just here. You can ask us questions. We check it every day. We stalk our Facebook group so that we don't miss anything. You'll hear, like I said, you'll hear about contests, you'll hear about rules, you'll hear about how to do it. They're very easy. Our last giveaway, we did a review on, Colleen reviewed cutter bees and I reviewed beadatives. And then we talked about the similarities and differences in both of them. And I got the nickname of having short, stubby fingers. So if you want to go back and watch that episode, it is very funny. And it's been a lot of fun, guys. So we will see you next time.
Happy crafting.